That's right, we've got music going, and so this is becoming a more multimedia remote sensing experience for your viewing pleasure. So, yeah, I thought I'd start creating some of these videos specific for the labs. I've heard a little bit from folks with Lab 6 that it's been a challenge. You know, I'm trying to figure out what the biggest challenges are with remote desktop, so please, you know, don't hesitate to shoot me an email, post to the discussion boards, and it'll be really helpful for me to know where people are struggling, what you all are getting hung up on, so I can, you know, provide some more guidance for how to, you know, work through the labs. I've been using remote desktop for this lab, and I didn't run into any trouble, so if you're running into trouble, it may be because there's something that we can do to help things process more quickly, etc. So, yeah, I thought I'd make these videos to kind of provide some more support so that you'd be able to see kind of step-by-step where you're going to go with the lab. I won't articulate each individual step. I won't show that on screen, but you'll at least be able to see what the, you know, products are for each of the steps. So without further ado, we'll jump into Lab 7, Unsupervised Classification. Anyways, I'm going to start off by downloading Lab 7 here. And it's downloaded, so I'm going to open it up. And you can see again that it's downloaded to the downloads folder. So just like I showed in my data management video, we're going to want to drag that over to documents. And that'll be just a nice place to keep it. So then I'll extract it. Okay. So in this lab, you're going to be led through unsupervised classification, which is really one of the important topics in remote sensing. There are essentially two types of classification. There is supervised classification and unsupervised classification. In unsupervised classification, you're basically going to run an image through an algorithm, and it's going to create these clusters of similar pixels. And so essentially the algorithm will be looking at the values for each pixel across all the bands and then grouping them so that pixels with similar spectral characteristics are all grouped together. So the this can be really useful because it does a decent job in a lot of instances of grouping these pixels in ways that get at some of the patterns in a landscape. So agriculture or forest or urban areas can be clustered together in these different ways. So it'll be a good opportunity to explore this important topic of remote sensing. Alright, so I wanted to kind of walk through some portions of this this lab. My hope is that it'll be pretty straightforward for you. One of the previous TAs had added in a bunch of notes and kind of annotated out a lot of the steps you'll be going through in more detail than is covered in the lab. But I just wanted to show you some of this. So, you know, it kind of describes the background of the lab. Again, you're going to be doing this unsupervised classification. And a lot of the same, a lot of this is stuff we've done for each lab. Examine the data directory structure, document the map, and those kinds of things. For documenting the map, I do have a Word document that helps to describe how to do that in case you forgot. So I'll put that up on Canvas so that's obvious. And then you're going to just go through this series of steps for the first part. So step one is to identify and map designated watersheds. So we're going to be looking at these three watersheds in this lab, and you're going to basically be overlaying those watersheds on satellite imagery and overlaying on that some rivers and roads for this first section. So you'll go through those steps, and hopefully that'll be fairly straightforward. And then I just wanted to show you what you can expect as far as an outcome. So I'm going to be doing this lab entirely on remote desktop, just so that I can simulate any trouble spots that people will come up against. And so, yeah, then hopefully I'll be some more help to you if you get stuck. And so after you go through these steps in data mode, it will look like this. And then if I swap over to layout view, you can see I've put together a map. And this is really a finished map for this first section. So you'll want your map to look something like this. That's kind of most of it for the first section here. So I'm now on to step two, where we're actually going to be classifying this image using unsupervised classification. And so there are going to be a number of steps that you'll go through here. But I wanted to show you, once you actually start running the classification, something you're going to want to make sure you do. So I'm going to go through those steps, and you'll be led through these. But when I go to run this, it's going to open up this ISO cluster unsupervised classification window, and you'll be led through this, but you're going to type in 40 for the number of classes. Now, what I wanted to point out is that you really want to pay attention to this output classified raster. And mine I set so that it's going to go to my documents folder. Yours may not. So you're going to want to navigate with this to make sure that it goes to whatever folder you're eventually going to upload to the end drive. Because obviously if this goes to some other folder and you don't upload it to the end drive, then you're gonna lose the data when you try to come back to it. So just keep that in mind. I'll keep trying to point those things out, but that was something that seemed like it'd be easy to miss and then regret it later. So that's all for now. So then once you've gotten through the steps for the unsupervised classification, so this is all of step two in the lab, you'll have something like this. Your colors will probably be a little bit different. And so next we're actually going to look at the classes for each of the kind of what they relate to on the ground. So which of the classes are urban, forest, etc., and be kind of looking for associations that way. So, on to step three. So, I just did step three, which was determining the land cover classes for this map. So what I did is just copy and pasted the chart from the Canvas page, from the Canvas quiz, into Word, and then just went through each of the classes and said what I thought they were. So this is all described in the lab, and you'll see that. Basically, it's going to be developed, forested, water, wetlands, and what was the last one? Crop and pasture. And so, the way I did it, that worked fairly well. It's a little slow. You can see as I'm kind of zooming around. But basically, just open up the attribute table and click through the different classes. And then, like this one, there are a lot of pixels here in this class. So at that point, I would turn off my layer for that and look at what's underneath. So this one would be a developed class because you can see there's houses underneath. And some of the classes might not be super clear cut, so you're just going to have to make some decisions on those. You know, there are going to be mixed pixels. It's not a perfect science. So you're going to make the best call you can. But what I would suggest is for each one, you know, kind of zoom out. And then it occurred to me that you probably can't see what I'm clicking down in the attribute table because my big head is in the way. But say I wanted to look at this class, I would be zoomed out and then I would say, oh, there's a lot of pixels in this class over here. And then I would zoom in and it's going to kind of freeze on you because it's just the nature of ArcGIS. It's not even a remote desktop thing. But yeah, and then you'll want to turn this off and you'll just kind of have to mess with it to get it to work for you. It's, you know, it is what it is. So there we go. So now I can unclick this and I can look underneath and I can see this one looks like pasture underneath. So pasture is a number 4, so I would mark down number 4 for that. For number 36 it is. So down at 36, and sure enough, I already went through and marked a 4 for that. So, yeah, that's that step. And now, I'm going to go and reclassify my map. Alright, so I just finished step 4 and I wanted to show some of my results on the screen here. So in this step I classified the map, reclassified it using the steps that I showed earlier, and I'm pretty happy with how it turned out overall. You can see that the water is very distinct in this color here. The forested areas and urban areas really stand out, and if you just remember back to the original map with the 40 classes, that was really not at all obvious. And in the upcoming steps, we're going to go through a few more steps to kind of smooth out some of the classes, and we'll see what kind of results we come up with. Alright, I just finished step 5, which is kind of cleaning up some of the boundaries of the classes. So, got to this point where it asks us to use the swipe tool to compare what was produced with the original. And so, you can see before it was like these 40 classes that there wasn't anything distinct about the classes, and now, you know, we have something here that's relatively reasonable. So I'm going to zoom in and just look at this in a little more detail here. And so zooming in on this area, it looks like it's a somewhat urban area with some forest and then some patches of pasture around. So I'm going to swipe down, and where you can barely make out a lot of the classes before, now you can really clearly make them out. So the next thing I kind of want to do, just because I'm curious, is to zoom in even a little bit more and just compare how these classes look with the base map. I imagine it's not great, but we will see. So I think it's decent. You know, this is definitely pretty densely urban, and then there's some more forest through here. So you can see some of that trend there. This is also very dense, and it's showing up as urban areas. So yeah, I think it's done a relatively decent job, and I'm fairly happy with it. So next we'll move on to step 6. You'll have a few questions in this section that you'll just want to answer as well. So. So step 6 is kind of just cleaning things up on the map. And so basically all that you're going to end up doing is creating a new field to actually name the classes what they're representing. So you'll have, water, forest, developed, pasture, crop, and wetland. And then you'll symbolize them with appropriate colors. So I chose red for developed, for example, green for forest, bright green for wetland, blue for water, and yellow for pasture and crop. So for step 7, you're going to be doing a little bit of processing so that you can do some quantitative analysis of the different watersheds. Basically, you're going to be looking at how the watersheds differ in their proportion of the different land cover classes. And so right now, you just have one raster layer with all of the classes that we've classified. So what you're going to do is you're going to be extracting those out for each individual watershed. And I think the steps in the lab here will kind of lead you through that. And you're going to answer a bunch of questions about the dominant land cover type and the different watersheds, which watershed is nearest to Chesapeake Bay, just some kind of interpretation type questions about what we produced. And then the last piece for step 7 is a map of the unsupervised classification. And so you can see I've got my map here. It's fairly simple. It just has the legend, north arrow, scale bar, and title. And then it shows my map. And something with like this will be absolutely fine. And now we're really on to the home stretch with step 8. So the last step will be step 8. And this basically you're just going to create a graph of the proportion of cover in these different watersheds. So one of the things that I should have mentioned is that because some of this is somewhat subjective, right? We're making calls between forested and urban, when in some, of course, urban areas have trees too. So there might be parts that I would call urban that you would call forested, or between wetland. What's the line between wetland and water? So yours will look a little bit different than this. And that's perfectly fine. Your maps will look a little bit different than this, and that's fine too. But you are going to want a graph that looks like this. Last thing that I wanted to remember to show you, not to do with the lab, but just a reminder. So I just want to remember to, you'll just want to remember to move your lab data off of the local computer and put it onto the end drive. So again, the way I do this is I just open up a couple of instances of Windows File Explorer, and I'll put that there and here, and then I'm just going to go to the N drive, and then to My Files, and I have this folder for NR323, and so it's this folder that I saved everything in, so I'm just going to drag that over. And it might take a minute. And anyways, once it's done, then your stuff is safe on the end drive and you are good to go. So that's the last piece. I hope this was helpful, and catch you later.